Is it possible to pay off $100,000 in student loans and still do the things you value?
All that's coming up in today's video, so hit that like button and let's get started. Hello there, I'm Caleb, and in today's video, I interviewed Barlow, who is a Chicago attorney. I found Barlow from her YouTube channel, Barlow Street, where she budgets out her paychecks using YNAB as a way to encourage those who are also on a budgeting journey. Through her undergraduate and her law school programs, she ended up taking out about $108,000 of student loans, but then paid it off as quickly as she possibly could after school. Her story certainly had its own set of challenges, and I really enjoyed hearing the wisdom that she had to share on the topic of getting an education and paying off your student loans. It's very motivational for those who might be in the same boat. So let's get into it.
Hi, I'm Barlow, and you may know me from the channel Barlow Street. Caleb asked me to join him to talk about my journey, paying off my student loans, and just my financial journey in general.
What made you decide to become an attorney?
When I was younger, I really, really wanted to be a teacher or a therapist. When I went to a college, I thought, well, I will study psychology, but I should study something else I might use. I'm gonna double major in psychology and computer graphic design. When I graduated in 2008, there were not any psychology or computer graphic designs to be had.
Yeah.
And so I actually went into politics for a little bit. And it was sort of through that experience and my time in DC that I decided to go to law school.
So in terms of going to law school and just college in general, what was the financial situation surrounding that? How did you pay for it?
When I was preparing to go to college, I was 16 or 17 and a senior in high school. And I had spent most of my life in foster care. And I was not going to be adopted at 16 or 17. And so I had to start thinking about college. My foster parents were not terribly interested in my interest in college or in me generally, so they weren't particularly helpful, but I did find some online resources and some guidance counselors who were able to direct me towards some scholarship applications. Once those scholarship offers came in, either declined or offered, I was pleased to find that I had most of my cost of attendance for college covered. I ended up taking out about $13,000 of student loans for undergrad. And then because I was really afraid of debt, no real reason, I just was, I sort of went very aggressively at paying off my undergrad student loans. And then of course, turned right back around and took on a whole bunch more. Mistakes were made.
So your undergraduate, you took out about $13,000 of student loans, right? And then when you went to law school, what was the situation with that?
As it happened, I was looking at NYU, which is where I went to law school. I was looking at their webpage and noticed a full ride available, and I had not applied for it when I applied to NYU. So I called and I took a chance. I don't usually do this, but I called and asked for an exception. And I said, I didn't see this on here. I very much want to apply for the scholarship. Please, won't you make an exception? And they did. They told me they would just use the essay I'd submitted. Because it was still about overcoming adversity and my own experiences. And a few days later, they called me and said that I was going to interview with some very sexy lawyers, like the biggest and baddest lawyers of them all, the Supreme Court. So I interviewed at the Supreme Court and I got a call at 8:30 that I got a full ride and I immediately accepted it. So law school for me, I thought was really taken care of.
Mm-hmm.
But here's the tricky part. You may have heard me mention earlier that I went to NYU. And NYU is in downtown Manhattan. So it was quite expensive just to live there, right? Yeah. So set aside tuition, which was fully covered, I still took out $75,000 of student loans to pay for rent, food, books, therapy, whatever else people regularly spend on. And I was not being extravagant. You know, you hear the full ride and you think, why on earth does she have any loans? And the reason for that is full tuition scholarship.
Yeah, and you still had all those living expenses. You've said before that it was about $108,000 of student loans total between your undergraduate and law school. You were trying to pay them as you went, but you still had some after finishing law school and everything. How long did it take you to pay that off? And like, what was your income at the time?
So when I first started at my law firm, lockstep started at 160. So I was making $160,000. And I do remember looking at all of the student loans all in that I had taken out at some point, and it was like $108,000. But I think by the time I started at my law firm job, it was probably $98,000, something like that. It wasn't good, I ended up paying them off 4 years after graduation, almost to the day.
When someone does find out that you paid off that much in student loans, you know, what do they say?
I guess I get like a few different reactions. The primary one is a question that I think I have the same question I have for actually someone else on YouTube, which is, do you regret paying them off so quickly?
Yeah.
Right now that we're in an environment where people are talking about loan forgiveness, you kind of wasted a bunch of money. You could have waited for those loans to be forgiven. Do you regret it? And for me, the answer is absolutely not. I don't enjoy being in debt. I don't like feeling compelled to continue working. And so for me, I don't regret it at all, period. The second reaction that I get is folks saying that, oh, that's great and awesome job for you, but you were only able to do that because of your high salary. And to that I say, probably. They're probably absolutely right. I don't know how I would have paid off, you know, those loans if I weren't making $160,000 a year, but that salary came at a cost. It came at a personal cost. It came at a mental health cost. There were times when it came at a physical cost. And additionally, I also had all these student loans. So it wasn't like I was living on $160,000. I was living on about a $60,000 salary because between my student loans and, surprise, surprise, I was a foster parent at the time. So, you know, I'm parenting kids and paying off my loans. So it wasn't just me being 25, balling out beyond control and having a good time.
Yeah.
It was hard. It was challenging, and I'm glad I did it. But I also won't allow people to undercut an achievement just because of my salary. It was hard work. I did the hard work. I dug in, and I'm proud of myself. And the only other thing that I will say is it bears reminding people that law school costs $74,000 a year.
Yeah, okay.
And I just want to put that number out there because I think it's helpful to understand the context. So these young kids are graduating law school at 25 with $240,000 in student loans. It doesn't matter if you make $160,000 a year or $190,000 a year. At that point, you've got an albatross that's attached to you. You don't have freedom, even with all that money. And then getting back to your question, the last reaction that I get is occasionally I'll get someone that says, tell me how to do it. And I like those people. You know, I'm not in a position right now to be a financial coach. I'm looking to pivot to that later in life.
Mm-hmm.
But I always enjoy when I get that reaction from people.
Yeah, I mean, it shows a willingness to learn on their part and a willingness to change their circumstances.
We're in a season of life where it really feels like life just happens to us and we have to deal with the consequences of it. And I think if you allow life to carry you, then right, you might feel victimized. But if you, the moment you stand up and take an objective look at where you are and sort of pivot to making change, to me, that's the moment you stop being victimized by your student loans. And I know that sounds like a ridiculous statement to make, but I'm gonna stand by it.
Yeah, well, I think that makes sense.
I think it might be time to thank our sponsor, Beans.
Oh, not coffee beans, Barlow. We're talking baked beans. Baked beans are a great source of protein. They're a great addition to any camping meal. And they're also an interesting addition to public art as seen by the lake in Chicago.
I've got a couple of pictures there.
So with all these student loans that you ended up paying off, what were some things that you sacrificed in order to pay them off sooner?
Well, I can tell you one thing I didn't sacrifice, and that is hitting the like button for the YouTube algorithm.
Oh, really? Wow, okay.
Yes. I continue doing that and highly recommend it to all folks watching.
Excellent. Well, we don't have to come back to the like button then.
But I think in all seriousness, I bristle at the idea of sacrifices because, again, it makes me feel like I'm not in control here. And I never felt like I was making a sacrifice. I felt every day and every hour like I was making choices. I did make a lot of choices at that time. Some of them were wise, some not. But I made that choice to work at Starbucks. Again, super tired all the time. Maybe not the best choice, but it got me closer to my goal. I also made the decision to forego takeout, you know, coffee out, some vacations, drinks, too many concerts, all that stuff. But I've always been very, very grateful for that season and how I felt in that season, which is I never, ever felt deprived. I always felt empowered. And I think 100% of that is how I talk to myself about my debt and my decisions. And I think we should be kind to ourselves, kind, but hold ourselves accountable.
So were there any tools or wizardry that you used to pay off your student loans?
I should say, there's no way I would be where I am today were it not for the day that I found, one, zero-based budgeting, and two, YNAB.
YNAB.
Or you need a budget.
There you go.
And I, you know, that was a game changer season for me. Before I knew I was doing my best, and I was, but because I wasn't tracking every dollar, there were some leakage is what I call it. Just dollars finding their way right out of my wallet without my consent. Budgeting was the starting line for the financial race that I was going to run.
What was something that you found was particularly challenging about paying off your student loans as quickly as you did?
Boredom, the desire to have fun, wanting to treat myself. And honestly, the hardest part, and I know this sounds like after school special, there was a lot of peer pressure to not do it. There was peer pressure to, you know, ball out. And people said to me all the time, you're making so much money. This is the most money you'll ever make in your life. And I was like, probably, but that's why I got to use it to pay off debt.
If someone were to come to you asking for your advice in terms of them going to college or to medical school or to law school, what would your answer be?
On the college side, I generally recommend that folks take a year off. I think taking a pause and finding your place within the world is much more important than finding your occupation in the world. And so to those people, I say find the best school for you that doesn't cost an arm and a leg. Yeah. I mean, there's no other way to say it, right? On the legal side or medical school, and I think I can be a little bit more candid here, I think, and this may be unfair counsel, I should say, but I always tell people, and in fact, just told someone this morning, full ride or bust, do not take out student loans for law school. The benefit of going to law school is undercut if you graduate with $240,000 in student loans.
So relative to paying off your student loans, is there anything else that you'd like to add?
The only thing that I would like to add is there is a temptation in one's debt-free journey or in the debt-free community in general to focus on being debt-free. Mm-hmm. As it should be. But I think if you focus on that to the exclusion of everything else, man, it just feels like such a miserable way to live. And so I've talked to people who, you know, they don't go on vacations with their kids anymore, full stop. They don't give to charity anymore, full stop.
Yeah.
They don't visit their family during the holidays, full stop. And I'm not making a judgment on those things because they're choices, and sometimes they're hard choices that you have to make. But what I would like to add is in my own debt-free journey, I prioritized those things and I kept them safe. I put, you know, pillows around them to make sure that those things stayed in place. And one of the things that has stuck with me after my debt-free journey as I pivot to sort of investing to do financial independence and perhaps retire early, the giving has stuck with me. It's been surprisingly rewarding. And so I would just say that, you know, it's easy to get lost in all of the debt-free screens and easy to get lost in all the spreadsheets. But I think it's important for us to remember that we're still people. Mm-hmm. The people we live with are still people. I spent a lot of time trying to remedy some of that during my debt-free journey, and I'm looking forward to continuing to work toward that goal in my financial independence journey.
Yeah, great answer. You make YouTube videos about budgeting. Your YouTube channel is called Barlow Street. Why do you budget?
I want to be a good steward of my money. I want to know where it's going. And I'm a person that values controlling the things I can control so I can let the stuff that I can't control go.
What would you say to people who think that budgeting is too hard?
There's no one who's unfamiliar with a budget. We all budget our times. So that's why we have Outlook calendars or Google calendars or whatever platform you're using. You look at your day, you realize you've got 12 working hours, if you're me, and you've got 14 hours worth of work to do. So you've got a shortage. What are you gonna allocate the time to? Something can't be funded today. It has to be funded tomorrow. So when people tell me that budgeting is too hard, I just imagine that they've been talking to the wrong folks about budgeting, and they don't really understand that budgeting is not about restriction, it's about instruction. Right? You should tell your money where to go before it goes somewhere without your consent.
Thank you so much for your time and your willingness to jump in here and answer some questions. I know that your videos don't tend to have anything but your screen recording while you're doing your budgeting and everything, but I appreciate your willingness to jump on here and we can see the face behind Barlow Street.
Yes, I was happy to do it, and thank you so much for inviting me.
So as we finish out this video, I just want to ask you to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell.
And remember, money doesn't have to be confusing. You can control it.